ladies and gentlemen, Gary Moore.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Welcome to The Tell the Truth. This delicious creature to my left, her name is Gunilla. And Gunilla, will you turn around so that we can see that gorgeous outfit that you're wearing? Now, obviously, that's a special get-up. That's not just a let's get on the subway and go to an automat sort of a thing. It is a special kind of dress, and we'll find out what kind of special kind of dress a little later on the show, as soon as we say hello to our panel here on To Tell the Truth.
Peggy Cash. Mark Goodson. And wife of the Attorney General of the United States, Martha Mitchell.
I am surrounded by pulchritude on all sides. Be seated, friends, all except you, Vanilla, of course, who want to get a look at what you're wearing. I was telling our audience that the outfit that Gunilla has on is not just an ordinary outfit. It's made for a special occasion. Anybody care to guess what occasion?
Wedding.
A what?
A wedding.
That for a wedding?
Why not? It's pretty.
With the white boots and all that?
Sure, wedding in the snow.
Well, let's see. I'll give her a couple of little things to hold here, and we'll see how close to being right you are.
All right.
Gunilla, you want to put this on for me, please, if you will, dear?
It is. Oh, that's nice. It's her first communion.
You were close. It's a bar mitzvah. No, really, of course, this is a very modern wedding outfit. And a little later in the show, we're going to meet somebody who knows all about it. This particular one is by Contessa, and we're going to see you later on in the show, too. And thank you, Gunilla, very much. Martha, you're very fashion conscious, aren't you, with those size 2 feet of yours?
Five, not two.
No, yeah. I look at your feet. I don't know how you stand up. Your feet are so little. Anyhow, our first guest is an expert on weddings and wedding fashions, and let's meet him now.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Robert Houseman.
Number two.
My name is Robert Houseman.
Number three.
My name is Robert Houseman.
And we have to decide which one really is Robert Houseman, and here is Robert's story. I, Robert Houseman, am the editor-in-chief of the magazine Modern Bride. Although a majority of today's brides still wear long white gowns, complete with bridal veil, increasing numbers of young people are doing their own thing on their wedding day. Brides are wearing pants, gypsy dresses, and even swimsuits. Weddings are taking place outdoors in Central Park, on beaches, and even on the peak of Mount Rainier. One bride added a truly up-to-date note to her wedding. At the end of the ceremony, instead of tossing her bouquet, she looked one of her bridesmaids right in the eye and threw her a frisbee decorated with a women's lib symbol. Signed, Robert Houseman. Imagine throwing a frisbee. That brings a lump to your head, doesn't it? We'll be right back after a couple of commercials. Now, remember that all of these gentlemen claim to be Robert Houseman, editor of Modern Bride magazine. And we'll start with the peerless leader of Goodson Todman, Mr. Mark Goodson.
Thank you. This is a strange spot for me to start with, but I'll try. Mr. Houseman, number two, that outfit that I saw in that pretty young girl, how would you describe that? What is it called?
Well, it's a gypsy-type wedding gown, and I must defer to my assistant this time, but it is a gypsy-type wedding gown.
That's a gypsy type.
Gypsy-type with high boots, yes.
I see. Number one, what is the most bizarre wedding outfit that you've come across?
I think the most bizarre one was just the other day in the paper where I saw a bride in hot shorts.
Hot shorts?
Yes.
They're great, right?
Yes.
Now,
bizarre.
Right. Number three, what does this do to a magazine like yours, which really is this traditional, modern bride, even though it's called modern, deals with marriage. Doesn't this imply a sort of breakdown of customs?
We disregard it.
You disregard it?
Best thing to do with everything. Thank you, Mark. Let's go to Peggy.
Number one, do you agree that that was a gypsy costume that that girl had on?
Yes, I would.
I thought she looked like the Norwegian Snow Queen or something like that, not very gypsyish. Number three, has this new who made the wedding dress of Julie Nixon?
I believe that was Tina.
Thank you. And now, number two, when brides get married, do they still say that they'll love, honor, and obey, or is obey out?
They still say I love, honor, and obey.
Even in those hippie weddings?
Even in the hippie weddings.
Thank you. Well, number one, there's a tendency now for people to go go barefoot, more or less, when they get married. Is that so?
There is a tendency, but it can be dangerous, too.
Well, it depends on where you get married, I suppose. Number three, where do people get married in swimsuits?
In swimming pools, I suppose.
In the hippie wedding, it becomes love, honor, and oh boy. That's different than obey. Let's go to Bill Cullen.
That's the silliest question I ever heard. Where do people get married in swim? These barefooted weddings, number one, I think you mentioned the barefooted weddings. Now, in a traditional Jewish ceremony, do they not at some time after the wedding has taken place, do they not drink a toast and step on their glass?
The bridegroom does.
Oh, dear. May he go? All right, number one, I'll stick with you. What would a man wear to look in place with that lady who was out here in that Norwegian stuff? Number one.
He might wear an Edwardian type bridegroom suit.
Scare each other to death before the honeymoon begins.
Thank you, Bill Cullen. And Martha Mitchell, what do you want to know?
From number three, I would like to know, do you think that we're really getting away from the traditional marriage costume or bridal costume or dress or what? What do you think, Lon?
Definitely not. We're still in tradition.
We're still in tradition.
Absolutely.
What is tradition, number two?
Tradition is the long white gown with a long white veil and all in white.
And number two, here, have to give us a little more voice, if you will. Okay? Fine. Thank you. Thank you, Martha Mitchell. On the basis of that, we're going to have to vote. And we base our votes on whether we think it's number one, or number two, or number three, and we pay $50 for each wrong vote. We pay $500 if all the votes are wrong. And Mark Goodson, you have to go out on the first limb.
Well, okay, these men were all excellent, and really were very well briefed. And I'm now going to go on what I call producer's instinct and say the two gentlemen over there with long hair who look sort of withered, and the other man looks more like an executive. So I'm going to go with the man who looks least like it, which is number two.
Go for a magazine publisher type.
That's what
all
I mean.
Right?
That's right.
There's one for a two. And Peggy.
Well, I thought that Julie Nixon's wedding gown was made by Priscilla of Boston. I'm not sure, but I don't think it was anybody named Tina. And number one sort of looks like an editor, so I voted for number two.
All right, that's two for two. And Bill Cullen?
Gee, number two didn't know about that costume that the girl was wearing. He said he'd have to check with his assistant, and that didn't strike. And number one looked terribly friendly during the reading of the affidavit. And for that reason, I voted for number three. He was all I had left.
For that reason.
Number three and me.
All right, so it's one for three and two for two. And Martha Mitchell, you going to go along with the crowd?
I'm afraid not. Oh. I'm going for one. I think he fills the bill. It looks like it.
You feel fairly sure of it?
I feel almost sure.
Martha, it's the first time you've gone out on a limb all by yourself. Let's see how it works out.
I wasn't peeping at the other cards.
Huh?
I wasn't peeping this time.
No, you're not allowed to peek at anybody else's cards. So, will the real Robert Houseman please stand up? Friendly. Hey! Thank you, Robert. I want to tell you, the rest of you guys, don't kid around with Martha. She's making a bum out of the bunch of you there. Let's find out about the imposters. Number two, you got two wrong votes. What is your real name? What do you do, sir?
My name is Lester Sampson. I'm an assistant vice president with Manufacturers Hanover Trust.
And number three, sir, with one wrong vote. What is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Dick Cook, and I do public relations for the Jade Fountain Oriental Restaurants in Paramus, New Jersey.
Good job. Well, I'll tell you, ladies and gentlemen, we've got something quite yummy for you. Mr. Houseman and the staff of Modern Bride magazine have prepared a special fashion show for us. They've even been kind enough to provide us with five models to show us the latest in bridal fashions. So, Mr. Houseman, if you will please describe what each of your models is wearing, sir.
Thank you. To start our bridal fashion show, lovely Joe Wynn wears a long white voile gown in the Gainsborough style. Handmade Swiss lace is used for the apron effect on the skirt, the cuffs, and the bib effect on the bodice. It's accented by a roll collar. Lavender satin is used as a headpiece as well as a sash around the waist. This dress is by Bianchi. This is model Circa in a bridesmaid's dress for a summer wedding with a country air, designed in turquoise blue gingham checks of graduated sizes. It's trimmed with white rickrack. The shy girl look is complete with a matching parasol. And this dress is by Pandora. All the bridal bouquets are by Lawrence of the Plaza Hotel. Here are Barbara and Debbie, wearing a style that we call the rich peasant look. The bride is wearing a white chiffon blouse, wide belt, trimmed and tied with gold French ribbon, and cotton waffle pique skirt. The bridesmaid wears a yellow voile blouse, wide green lace belt, and blue print skirt. Both are by bridal specialist Contessa for Lord and Taylor. Pretty Mary is next, and she's neither rich nor peasant, just the sweet, innocent look of pink for the bride. The dress is silken organdy with white Venise lace trimming all over. The hem, cuffs, and neckline are banded with white organdy. The lace Juliet cap holds a long pink veil. This dress is by William Cahill for Lord and Taylor.
Oh, I love that.
Gunilla finishes our show in the traditional gown with a new look. It's pure silk taffeta. The dress is appliqued with lace on the double flounces at the hem, wrists, and neck. The gown is delicately threaded with blue satin ribbon, and the headpiece is a lace circlet with ivory and blue veiling. This dress is by Piccioni for Bergdorf Goodman in New York. And that completes our bridal fashion show that we were happy to prepare especially for To Tell the Truth.
Well, I've never enjoyed myself so much in all my life. Thank you, Robert Houseman. Thank you, ladies. And thank you, imposters, for being here with us on To Tell the Truth. What'd you say, Bill? What? You said something wrong.
Well, you looked exactly like a picture I saw once years ago of Tommy Manville, that's all.
At a class reunion, huh? Yeah. Well, Bill, I got something for you to look at. You might be the only one who can identify
this. It's an upside down airplane.
Sopworth Camel.
You think it's a Sopworth Camel, you
say?
It's a liquid cooled. It could very well be a Sopworth Camel, yes.
You know what it is?
What?
This is the famous Curtis Jenny.
Oh, it was a U.S. plane, yeah.
It's America's first great fighter plane. It's the one in which the United States pilots did all of their training for World War I.
Uh-huh.
Well, now, an authentic Jenny like this is one of many vintage planes owned by our next guest, and we'll find out just what he does with these aircraft after we launch a few flying commercials. And now let's meet the man who owns antique aircraft.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Cole Palin.
Number two.
My name is Cole Palin.
Number three.
My name is Cole Palin.
I ain't too crazy about any one of the three of them, if you really want to know.
Why are they all German?
Well, now, here is Cole Palin's story. Let's listen carefully. It says here, I, Cole Palin, am a World War I flying buff. For me, Kaiser Wilhelm never surrendered, because every Sunday afternoon, other old airplane buffs and I take to the skies to recreate the airplane battles of Rickenbacker and von Richthofen. The Curtis Jenny, the Spad, and the Sopwith Pup are all part of our living museum of the air. Most of my planes are genuine 50 and 60-year-old antiques. But in the case of the Fokker triplane, there is no original model today anywhere in the world. In order to add this important aircraft to my collection, I procured the original plans and engine and recreated an exact duplicate. I made it all by hand, a project that took more than 1,600 hours. When I fly the Fokker triplane in my air show, I always reenact the role of the villainous flying Baron von Nasty Nasty, who never wins a fight. Signed, Cole Palin. And let's start the questioning with the high-flying Martha Mitchell.
Well, Gary, you've got me in a bad point because I don't know a thing about airplanes. I travel by train.
Don't you fly?
No.
When you and your husband have to go to California?
Well, that's when the president takes me on Air Force One, and then I'm not so scared. But maybe I can dig up a couple of questions.
Give it a try.
All right. Number three. Is it safer in your plane than it is in modern-day planes?
Yes, the airplanes that we use up in Rhinebeck are very safe.
Are what?
They're very safe.
They are. Number two, how long is 1,600 hours?
1,600 hours?
Yes.
In days, you mean, Martha?
Well, I believe it says here it took him 1,600 hours to rehaul. Am I correct?
Uh-huh. Yeah. You mean how many days is that?
Yes, in days. What's 1,600?
In days, that's a year and a half of part-time, not certainly full-time.
And number one, how...
Martha, you're rescued by the buzzer.
Thank goodness.
Getting stuck with the subject you hate. Let's go down to Mark.
I love this topic, too. let me find out more about this show. Number one, where is this a program you put on in the air?
This is an air show.
Where does it go on?
Old Rhinebeck, New York.
How many people come to see this?
Oh, we have 1,000, 2,000, sometimes as many as 3,000 people there.
Number two, how many planes participate?
We always try to fly at least four World War I's and about three or four other vintage types.
Number three, how did you get involved?
Thank you, Mark. Can we go to Peggy?
Number three, if you charge admission to see this these air battles, right?
That's correct.
Well, how can you keep people from just looking up and not paying?
Well, most of the activity takes place in a small, concentrated area, which we can supervise the paying of.
But I mean, a guy can just park his car outside and just look at it for nothing, couldn't he?
Sometimes they sneak around.
Number one, has your flying circus, or whatever you call it, ever been used in a motion picture?
Not as such, but many of the pilots in our group took part in The Magnificent Men and Their Flying Machines. Perhaps you recall the movie.
Well, I was thinking, number three, has any other movie been filmed up, scenes filmed in Rhinebeck?
Yes, there's quite a few movies been filmed in Rhinebeck with old antique airplanes.
Thank you. Now...
And that takes us to the one man who really ought to know about airplanes, Bill Cullen.
I know that the Rhinebeck show is very well known, and they have some beautiful replicas of airplanes, real antiques out there. Number one, who's Paul Mance?
Paul Mance is a fellow on the West Coast that had stunt pilots and vintage airplanes and so forth.
Number two, number three said that those airplanes, those vintage airplanes that you have up there are as safe as today's airplanes. Do you go along with that?
In one respect, certainly. They're much more prone to incident, but when the incident happens, it usually happens at 35 or 40 miles an hour.
And there we go. We've learned all we're going to learn. At the moment, on the basis of that, we must take our little crayons and our little ballots, and we mark them for number one, or for number two, or for number three. We pay $50 for each wrong guess. We pay $500 if nobody comes up with the right answer. And Martha Mitchell, you have to go first, dear.
This is strictly a guess.
It's tough. Make a little mark. My, you write so daintily, but that is a...
Two.
A two.
You know why?
Why?
Number one, I'm guessing, and number two, he's made up so cute.
All right. So, two for his makeup. He likes that, number two does. How about you, Mark?
I'm in the same boat with Martha Mitchell, but I would say my hunch goes to number one, and I'm going partly on his answer to Bill Cullen about a fellow called Paul Mance that I never heard of before. Sounded very authentic.
It's a one and a two and a Peggy cast coming up.
Well, number one and two, when they said their name was Cole Palin, said, my name is Cole Palin. But the third one didn't make fun of his own name, so I voted for him.
On the basis that nobody makes fun of his own
name. That's right.
That's sound thinking. One, two, and three, and Bill, you got to break the tie.
Well, I had a surefire question, and dummy Roger rang the buzzer on me, and I didn't get a chance to answer it. And because of the vitriol in my heart, I shot number three down in flames. That's what I did right
now. That's a three going down in flames. So there you go. We're going to find out, see how it tallies at home with the real Cole Palin. Please stand up. Ah! Martha Mitchell, you're never going to get invited back here again as long as you live. You're making a monkey out of everybody. All right, let's find out about our imposters. Number one, you got one wrong vote. What is your real name? What do you do?
My real name is Bill Malone, and I'm the commercial announcer on Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom.
Yeah. Sure. Great show. Great show. Number three, you got two wrong votes, sir. What is your real name, please, and what do you do?
My name is Bill Phillips, and I'm a member of the New York City Police Department.
Well, gentlemen, I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you to start your engines and take off, all of you. Thank you very much for being with us here on To Tell the Truth.
In addition to the cash awards, our first team of challengers will receive the Samsonite Classic Attaché Case featuring color-coordinated portfolio and exterior, strong magnesium frames, and stain-resistant cover from Samsonite. Our second team will receive For the Lady in His Life, exquisite golden tassel jewelry by Sarah Coventry, a necklace with golden tone chains converts to a bracelet and matching earrings, all designed by Sarah Coventry. In addition to the cash awards, our central characters today will receive Kara, a carousel wig with shaggy back, side tendrils, bangs, and a crown of curls, an easy care 100% monochromatic wig from Carousel. Transportation and other considerations provided by Chevrolet, featuring the 1971 Chevelle, America's most popular midsize car, new bumpers and grille, same solid, dependable performance at a Chevrolet price. Prizes or product mentions were furnished and or paid for by the manufacturers or supplier of the products and services identified on this program. This is Johnny Olson speaking for To Tell the Truth, a Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production.